You're in store for a great night. Susan Casey, I don't know if you saw her out in the lobby. She's intelligent, she's articulate, and she's curious. It shows in her writing. She has a very illustrious journalism career. She rose to the top jobs at Outside Magazine and Time. She was editor-in-chief at Oprah Magazine. And then she managed to get into the men's magazines, which are, you know, that's just hard. And I know because I tried. Esquire and Outside, although Outside does have a lot of women writers. Sports Illustrated, she also worked for Sports Illustrated Women and Fortune Magazine. So she's passionate about oceans and the animals that live in it. Her first book was Devil's Teeth, which was about sharks. And then her second was about gargantuan waves in The Wave, which was a New York Times bestseller. And then her third book, Voices in the Ocean, is also a New York Times bestseller. And I can't wait for this interview. She's from Toronto. She grew up there, and now she lives in Maui in upstate New York. So she's very lucky. And Doug Stanton is our guest host, and it's normally impolite to brag about your husband, but tonight I will. So he also has written for a lot of great magazines, and I won't list them all, but there's Outside, Esquire, Men's Journal, and a bunch of others. And he's written two New York Times bestsellers, and he's at work at a third one, which I super hope is another one. He grew up here. He came up with an idea for National Writers Series in 2009. So Susan, if I'm counting right, is our 85th author. Isn't that crazy? So if you see Doug's mom, thank her, because she's done posters for almost every doggone event and provided flowers. So anyway, thank you. Thanks for coming. And please give a warm welcome for Susan and Doug.
Wow, number 85.
85.
I had no idea. And I've been here for most of them. Sitting right in this chair. You were here in 2012.
Right, with Anna Quinlan.
You were the guest host. I don't know if some of you were here that night, I know. And thank you for doing that.
Oh, so much fun.
It was
fun.
A great evening. It was really fun to hear you and Anna talk as we were driving around town.
Indulge my girl crush on Anna Quinlan.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah. I mean, what's so interesting about talking with you right now is, well, number one, you've just arrived here from Maui, which is puts you automatically in the envy column of everyone sitting in this room. And would you like some water?
Thank you.
And two, you're a writer and an editor, and we have some mutual friends, but you've carved out a place for yourself in the world of pushing boundaries, the world of adventure, the world of going places where people don't normally go. Tell us what Voices in the Ocean is about. We were talking earlier, and I think you summed up your question was, what do you mean that? So in the case of this book, what is that question?
Well, yeah, what I was saying to Doug was, well, my books all seem to stem from this astonishment when I hear something, and it's the question, what do you mean that blank? So with The Devil's Teeth, it was, what do you mean that there's a neighborhood of great white sharks with names that lives in the 415 area code? How can that be possible? And then
just tell the audience, what do you mean by that, by the way?
Well, what I mean is, like, how can that possibly be true? I mean, what do you, honestly,
where's the 415?
Like, oh, San Francisco, city limits. So There is a neighborhood. I mean, great white sharks, I think South Africa, I think Australia. I don't think, you know, San Francisco, but in fact, that's the largest population. And then when I heard the scientists knew them by name and it was the same sharks that came every year, and that there was a set of islands that really, at the time, nobody in San Francisco knew about. I lived there and I didn't know about them. And, you know, how could that possibly be true? How is it that there's a place so wild and so unknown in such an urban, mm-hmm. you know, it's 27 miles and it's a daunting 27 miles, but that's not very far. I mean, you're in Macy's Union Square in, you know, a day if you want. And so at the time I found out about that, I was at Outside and we specialized in knowing about all these places, and yet I had never heard of it. Nobody on staff had ever heard of it. So to me, there's always this big question mark. What do you mean that there's these islands and these sharks out there? With the wave, it was, I had read an article in the New York Times that, well, it actually said two large ships, like tankers, freighters, per week were being lost, disappeared, all hands lost. And nobody, I mean, what do you mean that we're losing ships at that rate? We can find atoms. How are we losing ships? So then, you know, later on came, what do you mean there are guys that want to surf 100-foot waves for fun? And who are they? And with Voices in the Ocean, it was a very deep dive into the world of dolphins, which is a colorful, harrowing, beautiful, mysterious world. And I guess my question for that is, what do you mean that these animals understand syntax? They understand sentence, that these word order in a sentence changes the meaning of it. How can that be possible? And they understand it probably faster than we do. And the more I learned about dolphins, the more that question just kept popping up everywhere. You know, what do you mean that there's a place where they sell brides for dolphin teeth? And what do you mean that, you know, these animals have had these big brains for 35 million years and the brains are constructed so differently that they may even have a completely different reality than we do? So just, the questions about dolphins just went on and on and on. Mm-hmm. I still have them.
You still do?
Oh, yeah.
I remember when you were writing this book, we would talk on the phone occasionally, and you would tell me interesting things about it, and one of them was just this idea of the dolphin sense of self. So you say that their brains are 35.8 million years older than our brains?
Approximately. I mean, give or take a million. Or, I mean, right. We don't really know, but I mean, dolphins have this wild evolutionary path where they're From start to finish, they're 95 million years old, but they started on land. So it was described to me as small-hoofed wolves, which is a hard image to actually picture. And then these small-hoofed wolves went into the ocean and became large predators, solitary predators, with not particularly big brains, at about 55 million years ago. And then something happened in the evolutionary path, and, well, lots of other creatures didn't change this dramatically. Dolphins did it several times. They went from these large solitary predators with kind of small brains to small social animals with high frequency hearing who developed large brains. So it was like this crazy shape-shifting odyssey for dolphins. And they've had their big brains now for about 35 million years. And it's a really cool example of convergent evolution where their brains, if you look at a dolphin brain, looks like kind of like a human brain, but far more complex. There are a lot more folds and crenellations, and they have an extra lobe, but they have two hemispheres, and they're bigger than ours. And yet, the wiring, when you start getting inside, which is fairly new science, related to MRIs and CT scans, and the ability to really look in detail at the cellular structure, it has all these very big mysteries in it about how they're perceiving things. They're missing a critical layer that we have as primates, where all the information is input. The brain has different capabilities than ours do. It has an area that's super elaborated in the realm of emotions, and possibly even things like intuition, empathy, very interesting elaboration in this extra lobe.
Right. Yeah. You say that they can throw tantrums, seduce, infer, recognize themselves, all kinds of things. What did you learn by writing this book? You traveled the world. You went to the Solomon Islands. You went to Ireland. You went to Japan.
Greece, Hawaii, Canada. I mean, it was a big odyssey.
Right. Yeah. You went around the world in search of what?
Well, also, I should just also say that I specifically set out not to write just about bottlenose dolphins, which are the species that people think of generally when they think of dolphins. So Flipper was a bottlenose. But the dolphin is, you know, the dolphin species is this rainbow spectrum of everything from this little foot-long Hector's dolphin, all the way up to orcas, which are the largest species, and includes really crazy prehistoric-looking creatures like the pink dolphins from the Amazon.
Right.
And so there's their societies, their cultures, which isn't just a word that I'm using. It's actually, science has proven that dolphins have culture. They transmit information through generations. And once a species has culture, really interesting things can happen. So what I set out to do was to basically to go as deeply into these societies and cultures and find out why our relationship with dolphins was so unique. Because as I write, you know, emotions run very hot around dolphins. We're not very neutral on the subject of dolphins. And there is this long history of human-dolphin interaction.
Right.
And it, too, runs a spectrum of extremes, from really wonderful and magical to very dark. And I wanted to really navigate that entire spectrum.
Sure. I mean, if people have seen the movie The Cove or Blackfish, what you're really getting with your book, Voices in the Ocean, is the full picture. You're getting the spectrum of you going around the world, finding out the real story of why those dolphins end up in those nets. But I've been asked so many times in preparation for this evening, it's so been unusual, only in an indication of the interest in your book, to talk about the spiritual side of these creatures and our relationship to them, because there seems to be a quest in your book for a sense of purity or spirituality. Not necessarily your own, although maybe you could speak to that.
Yeah, I mean, I think a really important recurring theme for me is just this wonder. I mean, the ocean is 72% covering the planet, but it's 95% of the living space by volume of the planet. So we live on a saltwater planet. We tend to think that all the action happens on land, but it doesn't. And so the spiritual, for me, the spiritual sense is always a sense of mystery of what's going on in the world that we live in. In this realm that we don't often get to see. I mean, we're the aliens, really. Dolphins have, somebody said to me, a scientist said to me, if aliens had landed on the planet 100,000 years ago, which of course is nothing, you know, it's a second and a half, planet's been around for 4.3 or 4.5 billion years, and said, take me to your most intelligent life, they would have gone straight into the ocean. And the whales and dolphins, these great minds in the waters. So to me, I'm always interested in what don't we know? You know, I love writing about science, but I also, and I think science is where a lot of the most fascinating stories are, and often I feel like as somebody who is not a scientist, but who is basically a science groupie, my job is to ask the questions that scientists can't ask, the questions about the deeper questions about what we don't know. With dolphins, I experienced this, and I certainly met many people, and people come up to me all the time at book readings and stuff to talk about their own spiritual moment with dolphins. And it could even, for me, it's in the wild, and that's where you really see a dolphin being a dolphin and in its full majesty. But even in some captive situations, people have had these moments that really meant something to them with dolphins. And I experienced this and I wanted to understand it better. Like when you look into the eyes of a dolphin, it's a really intriguing experience that begs these bigger questions.
What is it like?
Who are they? I mean, well, you certainly get this experience of thinking it's a someone. It's not a something.
What does it look like when you're floating in water, obviously?
Yeah, I mean,
you have a mask on.
Yeah, I write about this really a lot because I tried so hard to make sense of it for myself. And two things happened to me. One, I would become very calm. And even if I was free diving and I was really pretty deep, I would forget that I needed to breathe. And time just became very elastic. And when I realized I have to breathe, I would always have this sort of ache, like I don't want to leave the dolphins. And you know, when wild dolphins are around you, it's because they've chosen to be. I mean, they can swim 40 to 50 miles an hour, they could take off in a second. Why are they there and what are they? You get this sense that the animal's communicating, but of course in a completely different way than we're used to. They're making noises, they're sending out click beams at you, so you feel the vibrations of them trying to understand you. What does that mean? I mean, the only answers to that are really become very metaphysical and esoteric.
We have some of those.
Yeah.
We have a clip of that, of those click beams. Joe, could we hear that? Is that possible?
There's some on that.
For just about 10, 15 seconds.
It's very otherworldly sounds.
Thank you.
hear it, it sounds like a buzz almost. That's the sonar. But they can make all these noises, like, I heard so many descriptions of dolphin noises, like barks, quacks, Donald Duck-like noises, Bronx cheers. You know, they can bark, they can squeal, they can whistle.
So those were all sounds made by the dolphin?
Yeah, even a very wide repertoire. You can hear some of them.
Okay.
We can't, they communicate in frequencies about 10 times, an order of magnitude higher than we can hear.
So they're choosing to be, because, you know, like barracudas or sharks, obviously. Well, some things do come to you in the ocean, but most things go away from you. So why do you think they are coming to the human being for company? Is there any science or any feeling you have about why they're drawn to humans? Or?
I mean, every scientist who's ever worked with dolphins has established some sort of relationship that has rocked them back on their heels. I never met a scientist who spent time with dolphins in any situation that didn't come away profoundly wondering these same questions. Like, what are they trying to communicate with us? They always seem like they are. I think they're very curious. I think there are times, like, the interesting thing about dolphins in general is that they are so much like us, and yet entirely unlike us, so unlike us. But they have the full repertoire of bad behaviors. I mean, they're not unicorns. They're not like all like sunbeams. And they can be pretty aggressive, and they can be pretty gnarly to one another. And you know, they have that full ability to be to exhibit bad behaviors like
humans.
So if
they had TV, they could have their own situation comedies.
Certainly, they have individual personalities too. So you have dolphins that are the life of the party. You have dolphins that are, you know, really, you know, social. You have dolphins that are kind of retiring and quiet and not, and different species tend to be more outgoing than others. Bottlenoses are really curious, will come right up to you and will look at you, want to hang out with you, but not every dolphin wants to do that.
Okay.
So some do, some don't.
So you write, grieving over your father, and you went swimming with these dolphins, and you had a moment.
Well, I was actually swimming myself into oblivion that evening, and I didn't expect to see dolphins. I thought I might see sharks, actually, because I tend to see sharks a lot. I swim open water a lot. I'm a competitive swimmer, and
You went to college in Arizona on a swimming scholarship.
Yeah. And swimming is my solace. It's my where I go to think, it's everything. And I used to see sharks all the time, and I would say, I remember saying to Laird Hamilton, who's one of the main characters in The Wave, how come everybody sees dolphins when they're surfing, and I see sharks? And he was like, Susan, you have to work on your vibe. You know, your vibe is, you know, and so I took that to heart, because he's usually right about everything in the ocean. So I started working on my vibe, but I still had never had a close personal encounter with dolphins. So that night that you're talking about, I did. And it was, that really got my attention, because I remember just time stopped, and I went from feeling very despairing to really sort of almost euphoric. And I got out from that swim, and I was pretty far offshore.
Where were you? What state?
I was in Maui, and I was in an area that was, there's nobody else around really, and it was kind of a nasty evening, and I wasn't really even sure that I would go in. I had gone to surf, but then the waves were all blown out, and I was leaving back to fly back to New York, and so I thought, I'm just going to go in the water. And typically, I wouldn't swim by myself far offshore in the evening, but I didn't care, really.
You say swimming yourself into oblivion, what do you mean by that? I mean, what was your state of mind?
Well, when my dad died, it was like losing my center. I mean, he was... The reason why I've been able to do all these adventurous things around the world is because he was always there, and I didn't have anybody else in my life at that time, and I would always call him. He was like my anchor, and he died very suddenly and unexpectedly, and I was having a really hard time getting over that. And one of the side effects of that grief, which was so humbling and so overwhelming, was that I lost fear. I had fear of nothing. It's like if your worst fear comes true, what's left to scare you? And so I wasn't, you know, thinking about, we had actually just had this big run of shark encounters where tiger sharks had bitten people surfing, and Maui's got a problem with this. And so, you know, I didn't really want to be bitten by a tiger shark, but I also didn't really have my usual sense of self-preservation, I don't think. So I just went out. And the water was, the rule is if I can see the bottom, it's, you know, if you can see the bottom, it's okay. If we can't see the bottom, typically we won't swim. But I could see the bottom, even though it was deep, and but not well. And so then I saw these large bodies with big dorsal fins and had this moment of thinking, uh-oh. But it was dolphins, and that was the first time I ever really encountered them. And after that, I don't know how long I spent with them. It wasn't very long, maybe 10 minutes. But it was profoundly memorable. And when I got out, I started driving back. It was really far away from where I typically am on the island, and I was driving for about 20 minutes. I realized I forgot to feel sad for like 20 minutes. So after that, it was almost as if it never got any worse after that. It started to get better.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's so interesting.
Yeah.
And then you flew back to New York to work at your magazine job.
Right. And I started Googling dolphins. And that's a rabbit hole. I mean, once you start Googling dolphins, and you know, I find out dolphins, the Navy uses them as soldiers. And you know, I read stories about dolphins saving people's lives and dolphins, you know, doing all kinds of science breakthroughs on dolphin physiology that are so fascinating. And I just, it was like a tumbling dominoes. I just realized how much there was that we didn't know about dolphins.
So then where were you working, by the way? Where did you fly back to? What was your job?
I was at Oprah. I was at the Oprah magazine. And
what was your job there?
I was the editor-in-chief.
Okay.
So I was, you know, I was in a big skyscraper looking down on Central Park and living a very undolphin-like life.
Right.
Yeah.
You were
more
really...
More sharks there.
Well, you had to have that vibe to stay alive in New York.
Yeah, I mean, maybe that's why I never saw dolphins.
Right, but you hung out in Central Park a lot, right?
I mean, I always tried to live near Central Park just to see the trees, to see something that wasn't made of concrete.
So you've had this, I think this, you know, thing in your life where you've had a very kind of corporate, highly driven existence, and also this other side of you called to nature. And I was just curious why you think we need nature in our lives.
Oh.
I mean, you know, you've just told an amazing story about being saved, really, by this pod of dolphins, in a way. But for those of us listening or reading your book, I mean, this is the thing we confront all the time right now. Why do we need nature? And what, you know, and how are we going to save it?
Well, another big underlying theme of my book is this idea of hubris and dominion. Like, dominion, I think, is at the root of a lot of our problems. This idea that we are in charge of it, we run it, you know, nature is ours to do with as we please. I really believe in E.O. Wilson's theory of biophilia, which is not that we run it, that we're in charge of it. I mean, you do not stand in front of a 70-foot wave and think that you're in charge of anything. And I learned intense humility in the ocean, and everybody I write about who spends time in the ocean comes away with deep respect for our place in the order of things. And it's a beautiful place, but it's not, we're not in charge. And so the biophilia holds that instead we're part of nature, and so we endanger nature at our peril because we're endangering ourselves mm-hmm. when we do that. And there's all kinds of science about the physiological effects of nature on people. And I mean, I think everybody knows their own story of finding solace somewhere. For some people, it's the mountains. For some people, it's the desert. For some people, it's the lake out here. And you know, there's mm-hmm. something, I mean, I'm at the point now where I'm not willing to compromise that anymore. I left my job. I chose to leave it because I really felt like this is my purpose, is to try to reconnect people to this. I think it's a critical time for that relationship to heal right mm-hmm. now.
What do you think is the primary crisis flashpoint when it comes to those issues? I mean, what is it?
It's what I think, it's what I just said. It's this notion that somehow we can be over here and nature can be over here, and we govern it and we'll allow this much of it to survive. And I mean, that's a joke.
But what do we need to do? I mean, what if you're the catcher in the rye, what are you trying to, what are we,
It's a really a plea for harmony as opposed to hubris. Hubris being, you know, us thinking, well, okay, you know, we really wrecked that, but we could go to Mars, and we can. I'm sure we'll have the technology to go to Mars. We'll be able to get, you know, get our, whatever we need from these places. We don't have to change a thing. Mm-hmm. We'll just come up with some new technology, and I think that's eventually going to come around to bite us hard.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it is a, what do we have to do? I think we have to open our hearts as well as our minds. We know we have so much information. We've never had more information. So what I would yearn for right now is an evolution of our own. So that along with our hearts, we use our, I mean, along with our minds, we use our hearts as we proceed.
You know, what I'm hearing you, the devil's teeth and the wave are both about men essentially confronting this natural wonder, or this almost a sense of apocalypse, either the shark or the wave. And you're reporting on it, but now what you're telling me is that it's really you, your voice, your person. You've left your job in New York, very high-powered job, and now you're seeming like you want to synthesize both this spiritual sense with this editorial and scientific and data-driven sense to create change. Am I anywhere close
yeah.
to being?
I mean, when I get in the ocean, or when I'm, it doesn't have to be the ocean even, it could be anywhere I'm around animals or nature, I just am constantly in awe of it. Like I was just saying to Doug before we came on stage, I was in Papua New Guinea recently, and I was diving in a coral reserve. And it's one of those places where you feel like you've just taken a psychedelic drug. And everything was so amazing. And there was corals that looked like Avatar wasn't just a fantasy. I mean, nature is that incredible. And when I look at these fish, I saw bumphead parrotfish, which are these giant sort of iridescent fish with these huge heads. And they're sort of looking at you with these eyes that are like the size of coffee cups. And Dr. Seuss was a realist. I just get so excited. I feel like I'm 7 years old. And so for me to be able to convey that in a narrative that takes people maybe to a place that they wouldn't go, or and that can convey somehow, like we live on this planet, I'm getting goosebumps even talking about this, where everything is astonishing, and even rocks. I mean, I was in the Smithsonian at the mineral exhibit, and I was walking around and looking at these rocks of all kinds, and these rocks that are colors you can't even describe, and thinking, what kind of a paradise is this? And we build these buildings, which are just crap, and we hate working in them, and we breathe in toxins, and we eat them, and like, what are we doing?
I know, nine-story
buildings.
We're
smarter than that. Yeah.
Wow. So it's inculcating the sense of wonder in your reader.
Yeah, I mean, I'm so excited about it.
Wow. I mean, because not everyone feels that way. I mean, I would say that 95% of the population doesn't feel that way, but they're still buying your book because they want to feel that way. That's your job.
I don't know that everybody reads my books. I mean, I was just laughing because, you know, we're coming into a presidential election, and you know, to make the bestseller, my book, Boys in the Ocean, was on the bestseller list in the summer and fall. And I mean, every other book was about politics or this or that. And, you know, here's this book about dolphins. It's like, I never take readers for granted. I mean, these are the people.
Well, you had that chapter, Dolphins and Immigration, that was really fascinating.
Yeah. We've tried to use dolphins for war. We've tried to use them to terrorize people, but they won't do it. They don't really differentiate the bad guys from the good guys.
Right. Well, you know, it's funny. So I'm listening to NPR this morning, and the question, and we talked about this earlier on the show, was, so 100 years from now, the story we're going to be talking about is A, climate change, or B, terrorism. And really, this kind of encapsulates what you're talking about. Is there a linkage? Is there a linkage between the way our politics are playing out across the globe and the way that we're relating to the climate? To the environment.
One thing about climate change that I should share is that The Wave is really a book about climate change. I mean, if I said I was out to write a book about climate change, that I don't think that many people would read it. Whereas if I say it's about giant waves and I slide in climate change into the narrative, I can get a lot more traction on writing about this. And I'm always trying to do that. there's nothing like engaging people's emotions to, I don't want to tell anybody what to think about anything. I want to tell a story that engages people's emotions, and everybody gets to decide for themselves. But I'm certainly going to share my own emotions, and the people who want to read it can join this party. Come on in. But I think when I was reporting the wave, what really got my attention was that scientists are like world-class arguers. They argue with each other all the time. They barely ever agree unanimously on anything. But what really struck me was how unanimous they were on the topic of climate change and how panicked they were by it. Because I believe that our idea of what it means and what it is not exactly what could happen. So I do think that the common thread between terrorism and climate change is the human mind. We are apt to encounter more terrorism, of course, and we're very scared of that because it's immediate and clear and present danger, right? At this point, a little terrorism makes us a lot scared.
Right.
Whereas climate change is a much harder to grasp threat, but it is so much more powerful because nature is so much more powerful than we are.
It's interesting, a lot of climate change just makes us a little scared. It's like the inverse.
Right.
Because it's slower paced.
Right. People think, okay, it's gonna be a bit warmer, the water's gonna be a little higher, and it's just so much more than that. You know, it could profoundly change the way that we have to live on this planet. We live in a period of just almost miraculous stability. A homeostasis that enables the flourishing of us is so precarious. In the ocean, 1 or 2 degrees is the difference between life and death for so many species, and the coral is a perfect example. And there are things in the ocean that are stabilized by temperature and pressure. And when those things change, it could have profound effects. Like there are these methane hydrates in the ocean that have tremendous amounts of locked up methane, which is a greenhouse gas, and when those warm up, they're frozen in ice right now. Mostly, they're stabilized in the continental shelves. If they blow out, we can have big landslides that literally create the kind of tsunamis that reshape continents. So there are all these feedback loops that we don't understand. I mean, we've only been looking at these oceanic systems and weather systems for a handful of decades with any kind of satellite precision or anything like that. There are probably 1,000-year cycles. There is so much that we don't understand about when we open this Pandora's box, what could possibly result.
Right, so a degree or two in temperature gradient raising over a 25 to 50-year period could melt those ice plugs, let's just say. But that would be a small change, but it would create this enormous effect on human life.
Right. I mean, right now the ocean is absorbing a lot of the CO2 the extra CO2 that's in the system, and that is largely due to the ocean regimes that we've been fortunate enough to have. That could change too. And then, so instead of like just a sort of a linear progression of things getting a little worse, it could actually be like this. It could be more exponential. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So it may not matter why it's getting warmer, it's just that it is.
Nobody really, people would say to me, well, do you believe in it? And I'm like, it doesn't really matter what I believe. I mean, these are such giant forces. Yes, I do, of course, believe it. It's happening. But, nature doesn't really care about our opinions in this matter.
So we started off here by saying if the aliens landed, they get the spaceship, they look around, I could go to the McDonald's or I could go underwater. They're going to go underwater and talk to the really smart people on the planet, which are the dolphins. What would the dolphins tell them?
Well, you know, we've been trying to communicate with dolphins for as long as we've known them. And in the 60s, I read about this, in the 50s and 60s, and even now there are these very intensive attempts to get dolphins to speak English or to somehow crack this interspecies code. But it is entirely likely when you start looking at how their brains are structured that they are actually, our idea of how they would communicate or how they even perceive their reality. And you can get into some pretty weird worlds of quantum physics and things like that.
Go there a minute.
I don't know, okay.
Because you explored some of these communities, right?
Okay, well, so here's an example. The dolphins have an extra lobe in their limbic system of their brain, and this is, as I said, the seat of emotions and intuition, higher level things having to do with feelings, a sense of self. We know that dolphins are self-aware. Not very many animals are, and that really means something. The idea...
We know this because they see themselves and
right,
recognize
themselves. Right. There's a scientific test that involves identifying themselves in a mirror. Elephants have... they call it the mirror self-recognition test. Elephants have passed it. Great apes have passed it. Dolphins have passed it. Dolphins were the first non-primates to pass this test. Lots of animals don't understand that it's themselves. And so it's a meta concept, this idea of me. But dolphins may have a completely different sense of self. And what some scientists believe is that their sense of self doesn't stop at the perimeter of their body, that there is a more communal sense of self. And because I'm not a scientist, my way of explaining this was to listen to all the scientists and then say, the way I see it, it's possible they have a level beyond empathy, where instead of I care about you, or you know I love you, or something like that, there is a sense of I also am you. And that actually then dovetails more neatly into what we know about the nature of reality in the field that connects everything. So it could be that what dolphins are experiencing out there in the ocean is something that we really, through our own lens, our 200,000-year-old, you know, we've had our big brains for about 200,000 years. We've had our brains for longer, but the brain we have now, it's pretty young. It hasn't evolved this kind of thing, and it's not too big of a stretch to think that if we were to evolve to survive for another 34 million years as a species, that we would somehow evolve a way to care about each other in a more connected way.
Wow. So the stranding of these animals on the beach may be an indication of what?
That's something that science cannot explain, and that actually does, the idea of communal self does then begin to explain some of these things. Why does a whole pod of dolphins or a group of whales strand when only maybe one animal is sick? That there is it's entirely likely that it's nobody is saying every dolphin for himself, you know?
Mm-hmm. So has learning this, has this journey change the way you view the world and change the way you relate to people and yourself? I mean, how is experiencing some of this changed you?
I think every book is just this profound learning experience. I mean, it takes me about 4 to 5 years to write one because I really want to get into these worlds as deeply as I can and spend some time there. And so I never come out without I think a whole new repertoire of experiences or feelings. In the case of the dolphin book, I always come out with just more humility. Just, mm-hmm. I hope that we can figure out a way to coexist with mm-hmm. these creatures.
And thereby coexist with what? X, ourselves or just... some of these groups that you met thought that they came from another...
I don't think I could write about a book about dolphins and not look in on the fringe. And the fringe, in this case, are groups that believe that far from just being interesting wild animals, dolphins are actually extraterrestrials. And the interesting thing about this is there are a lot of people who think this. And I spent a lot of time with one particular group on the Big Island in Hawaii, and... went there thinking, well, this is going to be pretty wacky, and of course it was. But I also came away really like having a lot of fun, and I mean, these people aren't—they're swimming with them in the wild. They're meditating on, you know, peace and dolphin love and all kinds of things like that. They're not harming anybody. Their beliefs are very colorful. I think they range from things that are generally agreed upon, like dolphins are highly intelligent, interestingly evolved creatures, all the way to dolphin sonar activates dormant DNA so that we can receive encoded messages from other galaxies. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I'm not the belief police. You know, I love, as a writer, I love to go into subcultures and hear about what people believe. And it was funny because when the book came out, a lot of people, I almost felt like there was anger that I'd even included these people. which I felt was pretty misplaced, actually, when you think of some of the other players in that book. Yeah.
No, I agree, because you spend a lot of, I mean, you go to some places that are dangerous, in the Solomon Islands, am I correct?
Yeah.
You were being followed there, and they harass reporters, harass protesters. Talk a moment just about the dark side of the dolphin here for a moment.
Well, the dark side of dolphins has to do with the trade, the export in wild dolphins for captivity. And dolphins are really lucrative. There are about 2 swim with the dolphins facilities a year. Maybe it's even a month. I can't quite recall popping up in the Caribbean, but usually where cruise ships disembark. And you know, a family of 4 can drop $1,000 in an afternoon with these dolphins, and you can pay to have a dolphin kiss you. And so every little person with a swimming pool somewhere near a cruise ship disembarkation wants a few dolphins. And so
They can have them.
They can buy them from lots of different countries, not from the U.S. because of the Marine Mammal Protection Act, and not from a lot of countries, but still, they're, you know, you can buy them from Russia, you can buy them from Japan, China, Mexico, various places, and they get trafficked. So a young female bottlenose can run about $250,000. If you could get an orca from Russia, that would be about a $5 million animal. So there's big money in this, and wherever big money, you know, big money, dark shadow. I mean, so in the Solomon Islands, the Solomon Islands basically is like the Cove on steroids. They have...
For those listening, the Cove is what?
Taiji, Japan, the movie, the documentary about this killing cove in Taiji, Japan, where these group of fishermen kill thousands of dolphins every year, and they claim it's to eat them, and they do eat dolphins in Japan and whale as well, obviously. But really, the killing is a cover-up for, really, they're one of the largest...
The kidnapping.
Right. Yeah. And so those dolphins are exported by the thousand every year, and people go to protest them, and that's not going to stop because of the money involved in the captivity. Whereas the Solomon Islands is a super remote country that is almost a failed state. Almost nobody, I can tell you right now, you don't need to put that on your travel list. You can cross that one off. And I went there because an activist they'd tried to assassinate an activist there. There are a lot of villages where dolphins were traditionally hunted for their teeth, and the teeth are used as currency. So dolphin teeth is, you know, you want cigarettes, give me 10 dolphin teeth. You want a pig, that's 1,000. You want a bride, that, you know, that's 1,500 to start. And the more dolphin teeth a family has, the higher its social status in the Solomon Islands. So several people came into the Solomon Islands and made it clear that there could be far more money for these villagers if they captured live dolphins, brought them to this island, this island was another reason I went there. It was like Colonel Kurtz's encampment in the Solomon Islands where all these dolphins were being held. And then they would be shipped out on chartered 747s to go to places like Dubai and Singapore and things like that. And so the Solomon Islands was very excited about this because the country was pretty much insolvent, and mm-hmm. that became one of their biggest exports. But then the whole thing, it just exploded. So every village, even the ones that had never hunted dolphins before, started rounding up all kinds of dolphins, not understanding that they only wanted certain animals and certain species, and not understanding that once you capture dolphins, you have to feed them, and you know, and they're not easy to take care of.
Right.
And so dolphins were just dying like crazy in that country, and all the environmental groups flooded in. And it's a very rough and violent place, and people were being beat up and harassed, and this one particular character in the book, they had tried to kill him, and they almost succeeded. So I went to hang out with him.
Yeah, that's what I would have done. Yeah. I mean, I could stay in Maui, or I could go hang out with this guy.
Oh, believe me, I didn't want to go to the Solomon Islands, but I went, and I am not going back.
Yeah. No, I can see that. Well, something interesting has happened in light of this, however. India recently made an interesting declaration, and SeaWorld has changed. Tell us about that just for a moment. What's going on here?
Well, India just declared dolphins to be non-human persons. So for the purposes of law, a person is not a human being. It's an autonomous entity that has some rights of self-determination. And there our lawyers right now working, there's a project called the Non-Human Rights Project that is using, like a river has been named a person in corporations are people under the law. So because of what we know about dolphins, the science of, they call themselves by name. Every dolphin gets a signature whistle given to them the same way we get our names given to us at birth, and they keep it through their entire lives.
Gives it to them? The matriarch?
The matriarch, well, or a mother or an older female, and a lot of the dolphin cultures are matriarchal. They're really long-lived, so the matriarchs, I mean, this is a realm where they don't write things down. The information is transmitted orally, and it's how they survive, because as the ocean shifts, as fish go here or there, or, you know, hunting grounds disappear or crop up, it's the matriarch who's storing this information and guiding the species. Orcas are particularly adept at this, but it's likely that many other dolphin species do this as well. They know where's plan B and where's plan C, and we know that they orally pass information and dialects, and we don't understand the substance of those messages, but we do know that they're passing things along through at least six generations, and
How do we know that, though? Because of recordings?
Yeah, and different pods have different dialects. It's the equivalent of nations.
Okay.
In a borderless realm. And it's probably how they keep from inbreeding with other clans and pods and things like that. So the matriarch, you know, the long-lived knowledge that endures is really important. So when you pluck a dolphin out of its pod, you might be taking that pod's means of survival, that their encyclopedia of life out of the mix. But we know you're taking an individual, and that individual has a name and relationships. And we also know, scientifically proven, that they recognize the signature whistles of other individuals whom they've known even after 20 years of separation. So we know these things. So the question is, if we know all these things about them as individuals, how is a corporation a person and not a dolphin? I mean, or a higher order ape? A lot of these animals meet all the criteria for personhood.
So the dolphins could be contributing to the presidential primaries at this very moment, too.
Well, yeah. You know, I mean, nobody's expecting human rights to translate to dolphin rights, but it does maybe mean the right to not be, you know,
imprisoned.
Held captive. Or
right.
There's certain basic moral rights.
It's an amazing thing to consider,
yeah.
Really, the ramifications of it.
It is really interesting because I don't think the law is going to support. I think the law is on the side. And so India just was, I think, the first to declare this, interestingly.
And SeaWorld has decided in San Diego to no longer do captive orca shows? Is that?
Well, you know, SeaWorld is a different story. There's a lot of, I'm quite cynical about this, and it's a very cynical decision. And their decision is based on, you know, SeaWorld cares about one thing, and that's the bottom line. This isn't my inference. This is based on their filing at the SEC and, you know, every statement and every financial thing they've ever done. This is what they care about. They say they're about conservation and education, but you know, scientists have en masse said you're misrepresenting a lot of facts to make it seem as though these animals thrive in captivity far more than they do. And the orcas really are not a species that could thrive in even the largest tank. So SeaWorld had said that they were going to build larger orca enclosures, but the film Blackfish really spelled it out. And people, you know, especially, you know, people are smart. Consumer sentiment about SeaWorld has changed, not entirely, but pretty dramatically. And so they're reacting to that. But they're also trying to get the state of California not to pass laws prohibiting captive breeding and things like that. So they're basically holding that $100 million investment in larger orca tanks hostage so that the state of California will think twice about, you know, basically slapping them on the wrist for what they've done to orcas.
Right. Interesting. Yeah. Listen, we have something interesting tonight. We have such interest in your coming, and we have a new feature that we're starting called Your Favorite Fan Wants to Ask You Their Three Favorite Questions. And I'm going to welcome a friend that many of you know, lives in our community, Juliet Schultz. She's the executive director at the Women's Resource Center. And when I had dinner with her recently, she knew your books inside and out, and came up with so many huge, interesting questions that were very complex. And I said, why don't you come on stage and ask her yourself? So with your permission, and I know you've already given it, please welcome Juliet Schultz to the stage.
Hi.
Thank you. Oops, sorry.
This is kind of like, this is your life or something here. I don't know.
Thank you, Doug.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you so much, Susan.
Thank you.
It's just a pleasure to have you back in Traverse City, and thanks to the National Writers Circle for making that happen. That's how it happened, actually, over dinner, like Doug described. And as I was sitting backstage listening to you, I do work for the Women's Resource Center, and our philosophy is empowerment-based. And I heard you say quickly, I left my job at Oprah Magazine, which is sort of a big deal. And, you know, we're working with victims and survivors of domestic and sexual abuse, and leaving is a really big deal. And so my question to you is, how do you do that? Where do you find the inner strength? Because I think that you, what intrigues me about you as an author is your inner strength and your risk-taking and your relentless curiosity to dig into things that may not be sort of the norm for a woman to look at with a critical lens. So where do you find that inner strength?
To leave, to just delve.
To do what you're doing.
I mean, I don't think I really have a choice. If I'm going to live my life as I would like to, which is to follow the things that I'm most curious about and most passionate about, I never see it as any sort of major risk-taking. I mean, I think with jobs, I don't have the, I mean, I was a bartender. I know I can always be a bartender again. I did make the choice, the conscious choice, not to have children. So that does give me a degree of ability to take off, to go here, to go there. I acknowledge that. I love the idea of being around them, but I think for me it wasn't my path. I mean, if you tell me, hey, there's a Tyrannosaurus Rex on the other side of that hill, and I could go see it, the type of person I am demands that I go there. And a funny thing happens when I'm reporting, I lose this sense of, I wouldn't say I'm never scared because I'm scared all the time, but I don't ever, I think of fear as sort of an, it's almost like an energy that I can use to help me navigate something as opposed to keeping me from doing something. So I think there's different kinds of risks. There are silly risks, and nobody that I have written about, even the most extreme athletes, the ones that are really good, they don't take reckless risks. They don't take flyers, you know, and I don't know if I'm, I don't think I'm being reckless when I'm in pursuit of a story. I am always careful, but I also, I guess I'm willing to do things because at the moment I'm really in it and I don't think about what could maybe happen. When you're very present, I have one experience that happened that may illustrate this a little better. I was swimming one day with two other people in Maui, and we ran into a feeding tiger shark. It was feeding on a turtle, and it was unhappy to see us. And we were, you know, it went into attack mode. It had its eyes rolled back and its fins tucked down, and it started hunching its back. And I know enough from the devil's teeth being around great white sharks to know this isn't good. And yet, at that moment, I remember I was watching that shark, and I couldn't feel fear because I was so present. When the shark eventually went away, then I felt fear. And so I think that when you're really in the moment, you're just in the moment. You're not really thinking about what happened in the past and that didn't go very well, or what might happen in the future and that would be bad. You're just being. And I think I do a lot of things according to the compass of where will I be happiest or where will I be most compelled to go, as opposed to what am I scared of? And I'm not advocating that as it's just what I do. For some people, I think it works to do the opposite.
Well, it's good advice. You know, go where you're happiest.
That's probably a rambling, inarticulate answer to your question.
Really good advice. And when you talk about calculated risks, for me, the second book I read was The Wave, your second book. Mm-hmm. And absolutely fascinated with climate change. However, you said, you know, I throw climate change in there and I throw a little of this. And so then we throw climate change in with surfing and we add a little bit of Laird Hamilton. And so I was absolutely fascinated reading about Laird Hamilton. He is a pro surfer. He's phenomenal. Calculated risks, right? This is a man who is out surfing 70, 80, 100-foot waves. Talk to me about a calculated risk as it relates to that kind of wave.
Well, I knew that if I was going to write about giant waves that I needed to see some giant waves and get into some giant waves. And, you know, I mean, that's sort of a collective nightmare. And so who's the best person as a guide? And so I knew Laird, and when I was at Outside Magazine, we had written many stories about him. I was following his career because I was always so fascinated by what impels a person to do that sport. I mean, and also, how do you survive a fall? And so he seemed like to me the person who would be most likely to be able to get me in and out of a wave like that. So that's why I approached him, and he was certainly willing to do it. I think of Laird as sort of otherworldly almost, like in terms of his relationship to the ocean. I think of him as almost like a Poseidon type character. I mean, you really couldn't make him up.
Describe him for a moment for people who don't know.
Well, he's 6'3". He was born in water. His mother gave birth to him in an experimental program in Berkeley where he was born in salt water. And then for reasons that like only fate knows, his mother decided to move to the north shore of Oahu, which is the pinnacle of what at the time anyways, the pinnacle of surfing and big wave surfing. So he was in these massive waves from a very young age and being mentored by the top surfers in the world, and then because of the kind of person that he is, just wanted to go onto bigger and bigger waves. And so far from being stopped by the laws of physics, instead he invented the gear that would enable him to do that, but nobody knew if it would work. So he was the Chuck Yeager, really, of big wave surfing and invented the means to get onto a wave that was too big to paddle into, you know, by using smaller surfboards and specialized foot straps and jet skis. And he's gone on to innovate other ways to ride waves. So to me, he was scientists and ship captains and marine salvagers and all of these people who are trying to understand the ocean at its most ferocious. Here was a guy whose life depended on knowing how the ocean was acting at its most ferocious. So to me, he was sort of the emotional heart of the story. A lot of the time, scientists who are studying waves want nothing more than to sit behind a computer and look at them as opposed to in the ocean. Whereas the surfers, these guys are surfers the way, astronauts are pilots, really. And they understand the ocean in a really visceral way.
And would you say that I've read a lot about him, but a lot about surfing in general. There's a lot of theory that some surfers feel that that is actually their religion. You know, there's a priest who surfs and really believes that being in the ocean and surfing in waves brings him closer to God. And so my question for you is that, I heard you talk about the calm that you experienced when you were around dolphins, and do you have that same sense when you're around dolphins? Do they have the ability to heal, and could they somehow help us in ways that they haven't yet?
Well, first of all, I hope that more than one priest surfs. They could all use a little more surfing. surfers do tend to become really obsessive about their sport. And for me, the ocean is the equivalent of my church. I mean, I certainly see it as a place of worship. As for dolphins healing us, science would say absolutely not. I don't know. I'm not a scientist. I do think that when you are in touch with that part of yourself, that the biophilic part of yourself, that something is more right than not. So, for me, healing is it's the word healing. Like, one of the things that's unfortunate is that there are, like in the captive dolphin world, there are also dolphin therapy centers where people are told, if you bring your autistic child, the dolphins, and you pay us $1,000 a day, you know, this could heal your child. Science doesn't support that. And in fact, probably hanging out with any charismatic animal that, you know, a child is going to love that experience. That's a great experience, but it's not so great for the dolphins in the swimming pools. But if you have a chance to swim with dolphins in the wild, and there are some places where you can do it, the Kona coast of Hawaii is a place where you can do it, and it is not harmful to the dolphins. When you're swimming with a dolphin in the ocean, it's the dolphin's choice if it wants to swim away. And it's really dolphins, I mean, they're faster than we are in the wild. They don't have to swim with us. So I urge people to go into the wild and swim with dolphins if they possibly can. And I think that's a really valuable experience and even maybe a transcendent experience. Did dolphins heal my grief? I mean, I don't know if I can answer that question. I healed my grief, but they helped. They definitely helped, as did other things. And I do think that dolphins have things to teach us. I think all of nature has things to teach us that we don't know. You know, here's an example. This is a really concrete example. It's not metaphysical, but dolphins have these amazing wound healing capabilities. If you take a chunk the size of a football out of the side of a dolphin, you would think that it would hemorrhage, that it would be in terrible pain, that it would be deformed afterwards if it could even survive. None of those things happen. When a dolphin has a huge wound, it will regenerate the tissues it needs, so it doesn't even repair it, it regenerates. It will stop the hemorrhaging internally. It will somehow, by some means we don't quite understand yet, not get any infection, and it doesn't appear that they feel any great pain from these wounds. So scientists have started to wonder if they are actually able to generate stem cells for various body parts within their own bodies, if they're extracting antimicrobial compounds out of plants in the ocean and storing them in their own bodies for use when they need them, if they're generating a natural kind of morphine, again, possibly from ocean plants or some other substance, or even internally, and using that somehow, like, they have these abilities that we are only just beginning to understand. And that's just the tip of the iceberg.
Interesting. Yeah.
So if they have the ability to heal themselves, then
what else can they do?
Exactly. Yeah. And I think, thank you for what you said about nature and other charismatic animals and opening your heart and minds to the possibilities, because I think you're right. That's the way, that's the path forward. So thank you, Doug, and thank you, Susan Casey.
Susan, both Juliet and I were wondering, would you read, before we go to questions with the audience, is there a page or so that, the book is right there on the table, that you could read from?
Do you want me to read the Minoan passage?
Yeah, that's great. The spiral passage, or?
Yeah, I mean, this book has, is a mirror that's held up to us in our relationship with dolphins, and as such, there's some hard facts in it and some hard truths about where we are right now and what we are doing. But I also didn't want the people to want to put down this book and think that there was no way forward, or just, you know, this is a massively depressing book. I mean, I don't believe that. I believe that nature is, I know that the ocean is incredibly resilient, and if we would just leave it alone for a second, it regenerates, but we have to do it. We have to actually act. And so I looked throughout history for examples of maybe civilizations that had lived more in harmony with nature and wondered what could we learn from them. And as it happened, the civilization that I found was the earliest example of dolphin art came from them. They were the Minoan civilization from Greece, who we don't know that much about them. They left a tremendous amount of artworks, very detailed artworks, many of which feature dolphins and other marine life. They were really connected to the ocean. They lived in this among the Cyclades Islands in Greece. And they appeared to worship, this is inferred from their art, a sort of a mother nature goddess figure named Potnia. And they disappeared in a cataclysmic volcanic eruption that scientists think happened around 1500 BC. They are sometimes thought to have been possibly the model for Plato's mentions of Atlantis, although that's, of course, completely unproven. But there's something very magical and interesting about the Minoans. And so I went to understand more about them. And I want to read, if I can, two brief passages about what happened when I went into the Minoan ruins and the Minoan, the sort of the whispers and the ghosts of the Minoan realm. This passage I'm about to read, I'm on Santorini, which is was known as Thera, which is where the volcano erupted and where this city was buried under ash, and a lot of these, the most magnificent dolphin art and evocative dolphin artworks came from. What did I hope to find there? As night rose up from the silence of the caldera, I thought about this. I suppose I wanted to know how a prosperous people had managed to live in unity with nature for thousands of years. In the modern world, armed to the teeth with technological might, we have chosen another route. We believe in dominion. Nature is ours to do with as we please. There is nothing we aren't willing to tamper with, even our own genetic code. Not long before I'd come to Greece, a paper was released estimating that half the world's animals had been exterminated in only two generations, and that was before you considered what has happened to plants and insects, coral reefs and rainforests, and other ecosystems. We are causing extinction, scientists say, at 1,000 times the usual rate. We know we are mowing down life. We've made charts and graphs, and we count everything on spreadsheets, but that understanding hasn't slowed us in the least. Harmony was a quaint idea for the rustics, our actions say, but we have more ambitious plans. And to put it plainly, our approach wasn't working so well. We think we have understood everything, philosopher Thomas Berry wrote, but we have not. We have used everything. What was it about the Minoans that made them embrace nature, especially the ocean, rather than fearing it, exploiting it, or trying to conquer it like other civilizations that followed them? Why were dolphins given such an eminent place in their world, along with other recurring creatures? Birds, bees, bulls, snakes, lions, and octopi cropped up often in their art. Trees were another favorite subject, and so were flowers. And what about that Minoan fascination with spirals? They drew that symbol everywhere. What did these things mean to them? And what, after all these years, should they mean to anyone else? And then you marked a passage. So that was me coming into the Minoan realm. And then this is me in a place where there had been this magnificent dolphin fresco. And it was in a room in a palace, the Palace of Knossos on Crete, that was known as the Queen's Megaron, and it seemed like it was possibly a place where there's indentations that look like it may have been bathtubs or there may have been fountains there. There are dolphins and spirals all over everything in this room, and it's a very touristy place, but I went backwards, so I had a moment or two by myself there, and I was just looking at this room and really getting the vibe of it, which was amazing. My reverie was ended by the arrival of an excited herd of tourists. Reluctantly, I moved on, giving the fresco a final backward glance. More than anything, I wanted to move into this megaron, to channel the Minoan high priestess or goddess or queen, to pour water into her alabaster bathtub and lay back and lounge there and feel what it was like to live in a society that took the ocean as its muse. I wished with every cell of my body that I could travel back in time and catch even the briefest glimpse of the person who had painted these dolphins. I wanted in on the secrets. I longed, as the Minoans did, to visit the depths and the heavens where only Potnia could take me. Though I was a card-carrying member of a culture convinced of its own linearity, I yearned to know life as a spiral.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
If we could bring up the lights, there you are. We'd love to, or Susan would be glad to answer your questions. If you wait for the microphone to come around and stand and just say your name if you can, and we'll take it from there. We have one right here in the back. Jan, do you see? There's. Thank you.
Hi, I really enjoyed your book, and I read it in 3 days, so I could know what you're talking about. You talk a lot about the culture of the dolphins and their ability, this amazing ability they have to communicate with each other, and how we slightly understand it. But when I got to the part about the cove in Japan, I couldn't help but wonder, year after year, thousands are slaughtered. How come they don't tell each other, like, don't go there, run away from them? Because you mentioned in many other parts of the book that they do, that, like, if there's a bad person, they'll stay away from them. Yeah. And I just don't, did anybody escape, any dolphin escape, and is there any attempt by anybody to veer them some other direction?
Yeah, there have been thoughts about putting pingers on the seafloor because they use noise to drive them into the coves. They create these disorienting walls of noise, which to them, you know, they navigate primarily acoustically. So that's like an actual object that's like driving them in this wall of sound. So, if, you know, environmentalists thought, well, if we created another wall of sound somewhere out there, but if you are caught tampering in any way with any of this stuff, you're ejected from Japan or jailed. And I mean, it's self-defeating. Ultimately, they're going to catch you. So that approach has not worked. The question of why they don't try to escape the cove is really intriguing, because if you see it, it would be so easy for them to jump over these nets. And why don't they do it? If they're smart, we know they're smart. There is no way to answer that question using our own frame of reference as a guide, I think. We think about, let's just save ourselves. They may have a completely different notion of what that means. They just get so terrified that they clump together and they won't leave each other. It's almost like a kind of paralysis that takes over. And we don't understand it. And I can only just hint at the possibilities there with this idea of this communal self, or also this idea of the notion that it might be better to just surrender to that moment as opposed to fight it. Or I can't explain that. Nobody can explain that. And it's disappointing because, you know, every so often a dolphin will get away, but sometimes they come back. And sometimes when a dolphin is released, like there have been people who've monkey wrenched in sea pens and cut enclosures, and the dolphins stay in them. I don't think we understand. I don't really have a great answer to your question, because I really don't think we understand what's going on in that animal's being at that moment. But it's certainly interesting.
We have a question up in the balcony.
We do.
Hi, my name is Michael Strom, and this is more about the wave. And when I read it, what I really enjoyed doing is you would have descriptions of particular surfers on particular days on particular waves, and being able to go to YouTube and typing that in and see a video of exactly what I was reading about really added a lot of scope and context. So just if anybody wanted to do that, it's really cool. And I guess the question that I have you continued to follow the surfers, and has anybody gotten closer to that 100-foot wave?
Well, I believe the 100-foot wave has been surfed. I believe it was surfed on December the 3rd in the incident that I wrote about in the book. We don't have documentation, but based on a lot of reporting and knowing what the ocean did that particular day, I believe that Laird and came very close, or possibly did serve a 100-foot wave that day. Since I wrote the book, which was in 2010, another wave has become popular in Portugal that really wasn't being ridden when I wrote it. This wave you've probably seen, where you can see it from shore, and it just looks, it's very steep. They've definitely had 80-foot days there, and I think this winter will become very interesting because of the ocean conditions. The last time there were ocean conditions like this winter in the Atlantic and Pacific was around the late 90s, and that was a particularly turbulent, wavy time, so keep watching YouTube this winter. And the wave is actually being made into a documentary series, so hopefully we're going to go around and update all the reporting that I did in 2010.
Will you be on that show, Susan?
I don't know yet, but Laird is now got a new toy. It's a foil board that's a hydrofoil that would enable him to ride really big storm surf, which is too choppy on the face. But the hydrofoil board is like a board that is a frictionless. Like, it's funny. It looks like they're flying almost when they're surfing. The surfboard's off the water about this high. So he's looking to take that far offshore into really extreme sea states. And if, believe me, if he goes, I'll be going.
Down here, or yes, go ahead.
Hi, Susan. I'm a big fan of your books. Thanks for coming. My question is on behalf of my 14-year-old son, who is very disappointed he didn't get to meet you this afternoon. Mm-hmm. And his question had more to do with your craft as an author. And in particular, he was really struck by the way that you... your books are odysseys. You know, you're going all over the world, having so many experiences. And he was impressed by the way you could remember in such detail how you felt with every experience, and wondered how you did that as an author, how you recreated that feeling.
I got some great advice early on from, being fortunate to work at a magazine like Outside and just watching and learning and, you know, my friend Susan Orlean expressed to me when I began to write seriously the importance of notes. Notes are critical, and you have to transcribe them as soon as possible. And so I document everything I can. I usually have a camera. I don't try to take good pictures. I just click away at whatever, but I mostly focus on my notes. And then I go back as quickly as possible and transcribe my notes and remembered as many details as I can. And you just cannot take enough notes. I mean, you would, I'm sure, agree. Mm-hmm. Like, notes are the journalistic lifeblood of any story. Mm-hmm. And I also I do a lot of taping when I'm having extensive interviews with people, and then I transcribe all my own tapes. I'm not obtrusive about it, but I do it because I really want to be focused on listening. And when I transcribe, which is a really time-consuming process. I've become a fast typist, but a lot of people are amazed that I transcribe all my tapes. But it, to me, it's important because what I'll do when I'm transcribing is remember things. I'll also note tonal shifts in people's voices. I'll note background noises. I'll note anything that comes to mind that is triggered by hearing that conversation again. And I have this belief, really deep belief, that if I write that the sky was a dusky pink, and I'm just making that up, that somehow on some level the reader will sense that somehow, and that will not resonate. So I make sure that I get every detail. I try to think about how the air smells. If I don't have it, I don't write it. But it's just this, well, I mean, like, my office after I finish a book looks like a paper factory exploded. I have giant binders for every character and every topic, and I do extensive scientific research, and I print out all the papers, and then I ended up with smaller files of the ones that are really valuable. It's just like this crazy, like, it's like making consomme, really, with just from a tremendous amount of material.
Yeah. Interesting. Someone else.
Hi.
Go ahead, Jan.
My name is Jan Doran. First of all, thanks for enriching our lives with your three great books. My question is, could you describe how your experience with John of God and your interaction with the dolphins has perhaps impacted the idea that there are things, that there's knowledge that's not normally available to the rational mind.
Did you say John of God? What did you say?
John of God.
Yeah. You said John of God. Okay, yeah. So he's referring to, he wants, this is about the, this is a metaphysical question. Right. Yeah. So John of God is a spiritual healer in Brazil who I wrote about when I was at O. And I heard about him through Elizabeth Lesser, who runs the Omega Institute in New York, where John of God is, I think, probably the world's most well-known, possibly the world's most successful spiritual healer. And when Elizabeth told me about him, she mentioned that I should really go. And I didn't know anything about him. it really resonated in my head. So I decided to go to Brazil as opposed to go to Rhinebeck to see him. And this is also when I was really struggling with my father's death, a little earlier than the dolphin experience. And so I went down there. He has a place called the Casa in Abadjania, which is in the heart of Brazil. And you know, there are lots of stories of very ill people getting healed there. And my feeling was, for the reader of O, who's very spiritual minded, if even one person has been healed at this place, then what's going on? So I wanted to, you know, walking this line between what we don't know and don't know, I used my own experience to write about what I felt, because I can't prove or disprove it, really. I can only go there in a sort of a neutral way as a journalist. I mean, I didn't go in there as a skeptic, because I could have just proven myself right instantly if I was a skeptic. I went completely neutral. I wasn't in the tank to believe it or not. And I watched carefully what was going on, and I spoke to a lot of people, and I had my own experience, which was that something really wonderful happened there. Is it him? He does seem to have some sort of power that, for me, the most powerful part of it was sitting in this meditation room with all these people. And so everybody's dressed in white. There are thousands and thousands of people. Nobody pays anything to see him. A real healer can't accept any money because it's not his power. He's a channel for this power, whatever this power is. And I believe that there is something going on there, and it certainly helped me, and I felt enlightened by the experience. I wrote the story, and it was also in 2010. I then became an Oprah show it reruns all the time, so a lot of people saw it. And I've never had a story result in so many letters and floods. And since then, I've seen him numerous other times. I've had experiences. I've talked to people who've had surgeries. I watched surgeries in Brazil without anesthesia that you cannot explain. I watched a woman have her breast operated on she was standing there talking 1 second, he put his hand on her forehead, she went unconscious. He had an unsterilized rusty knife cut in. I mean, there are lots of stories, there's footage, there's documentation of these things. Does everybody get a miraculous healing? No. But something good happens in some way there that is ineffable. I can tell you from personal experience that if I was really sick, I would go there and stay there. That's me. I think we all need to chart our own paths through these realms. I do believe that energy healing is real. I mean, we have no problem believing that our cell phones work or that our microwave ovens cook food. We know that we know we could feel emotions in some way. Our senses are young and maybe not that developed. But we have intuition. What is that? So I do think that we have the ability to probably expand our understanding and our acceptance of this, and it could help a lot of people. I certainly can't claim to understand it. You can get that story online if you're interested. I mean, I did my best to explain what I experienced there, but it's far from something I can just lay out and say, here's how he's doing it.
Were you on the Oprah show too?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, so people could watch that online.
Yeah,
so.
And she brought some other people onto that show that were pretty astonishing. They had pretty astonishing stories with film footage. Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Yes, go ahead. Here comes the microphone.
One last thing for this gentleman here.
Yeah.
So to relate it back to dolphins, I think there is something in the notion of the, one thing we know as a science, I'm always trying to merge what we know in science with what we don't know. So one thing we do know is that came from a study in England, if you're in a hospital and you play certain types of music, people heal faster. People are happier, doctors have more higher success rates on surgeries. You can actually affect people's well-being with sound. Sound is powerful. Like, one of the things that makes us come apart really quickly is incessant bombarding noise. And sound can also soothe. So I believe that part of what we don't understand or that we're learning, and this is something that I hope we'll continue to explore, is that there's something about frequency and vibration. on our beings. I mean, we're made of salt water, and if you pump, water is a really good conductor of all kinds of energy waves, particularly sound. I think that frequency and vibration are the key to that. And dolphins are the masters of frequency and vibration. Yeah.
Let's go ahead.
Hi, Susan. My name's Judy. Thank you. So I hear you talking about the communal body a lot, and it just brings to my mind the oneness that we may or may not be experiencing. And what would happen if humans could drop their barriers and be present, like your experience in the ocean with the dolphins, you know, you were one with them, and they, you know, they came to you and they hung out with you. And we all have those experiences in our lives, little snatches here and there. I just want to just say it out loud. What would happen if we allowed ourselves to do that? I just want to thank you.
Thank you. I love the question. I think that it is actually, the truth is that everything happens in the present moment. Everything we create, every inspiration, everything, our lives are lived in the present moment. This mind that we have is very good at projecting and, you know, forwards and backwards and sideways and everything. Every time I've ever had, meditation is powerful. That's all about being in the present moment. So I would agree with you that life would be more in the flow of things if we did manage to stay in that sweet spot. And I think that will be part of our evolution. And I don't know how fast or slow that happens. I know that from my own experiences meditating and being in sort of deep, relaxed states when I'm swimming and things like that, it's a beautiful place to be. Yeah.
We have time for two more, I think. Then we'll be in the lobby where we can continue the conversation. Someone else? Oh, there they go. Okay, who's ever closest to the microphone? Here, Barb, here's one right here. Could you raise your hand again? So, yeah, there she goes.
Hi, my name's Erin, and I work with children. And I know that you are going to have an opportunity to go speak to some high school students today, and that unfortunately didn't work out. But I'm curious, just hearing all of this talk about, you know, oneness and togetherness and being in the moment and talking about some of these topics that are kind of heavy and difficult to kind of grasp as adults, like climate change and our sense of self. How do you talk to kids about this who are still discovering their own sense of self? And what do you feel like as adults, how we should be mentoring kids on the beginning of this journey for them?
Well, I feel like kids are a little more clued into this than we are, actually. And as I said, though, unfortunately, United Airlines conspired for me not to speak to them today, but that would be actually my dream, would be to go around and speak to groups of kids, because I really think the kids, starting with the Devil's Teeth, I started looking out in the audiences and seeing far more numbers of kids than I would have expected. And at first I thought, wow, I can't understand this. And then I realized it's because they're so enraptured by these sharks, by all this stuff. Kids, I think, are much closer to the idea of wonder. I don't know if that lasts throughout their teenage years, but, I think kids actually have something to teach us about that.
So you wouldn't find it difficult to talk to them. You would say, a dolphin, we believe the dolphin does this when this happens. What do you think? And you might expect the kids to say, yeah, I get that.
I would love to hear what they have to say about that, actually. And I'm going to do a kids' version of this. I've been wanting to do kids' versions of the other books, too. It's not that kids can't read the books. There's nothing in them particularly that would be not right for kids, but it's going to be really fun to try to do one and make it a little more personal and make it a little more tailored to them. But I need to spend a little bit more time around maybe 10-year-olds to try to really get in that. But I don't think I'll have a hard time. I feel like a 10-year-old most of the time, actually.
That's funny. Yeah. One more, yes. Here, Barb, there's. Here comes the microphone. Hold it, Ann. There's the microphone.
Quite a while back, when we had younger children, we read a lot of Madeline L'Engle's and The Island of the Dolphins. Do you know her, or?
Well, I know A Wrinkle in Time. And but I mean, I remember reading that as a child. Thank you for saying that, because I think I would probably want to go look up that book that you just mentioned. Is it a sort of mystical? Yeah. I mean, A Wrinkle in Time was mystical. I mean, time is an interesting construct. It also could be related to the hardware that we've got. And there is an interesting relativity and flexibility to time. And anybody who's ever been in a situation that was pretty intense or dire has noticed time becoming elastic and interesting in its properties. So I think it's entirely, and we know also, you remember that book, A Stroke of Genius? Mm-hmm. By Jill Bolte Taylor, the neuroscientist who had a stroke, and she was able to, she lost the more rational part of her brain and entered into a reality that she was able to document because of her background as a neuroscientist, and had really interesting things to say about what happens when the sort of the police state mind shuts down, and I guess that would be the left brain. I think science would support the notion that if you swap in a different brain, your ideas of reality and time and perception would change as well. There's this really famous scientific essay called What Is It Like to Be a Bat? And it's an attempt to try to get into the mind of a creature with completely different senses and sense of reality than we have. I mean, some creatures only see certain wavelengths. Some can see far more than we can. Dolphins can hear at frequencies that we can't hear, far higher frequencies. What happens in those frequencies? I'm all for this kind of exploration in whatever form we can do it, really.
Well, listen, thank you, Susan, for a conversation that explored a lot of territory.
Thank you.
Really want to ask you what you're going to do next, but you may not know. And can you give us a clue, or are you just
searching? I think books find you.
Okay.
So I'm trying to be patient. I have ideas that I'm waiting for one of them to sort of click into place, because it has to be something that's going to be worthy of a book length treatment, and it also has to be a subject that I think I can bring something to that, somebody else hasn't already done very well. And I'm waiting for the muse to land, really, but I hope it takes me back into the ocean. But I think I do want to explore these more metaphysical realms, but with a little bit of science on board.
Right, I'm thinking, if you haven't read The Snow Leopard, anyone in the audience, yeah. It's an amazing book, and I'm thinking as I sit here tonight and talk with you that you've written your own version of The Snow Leopard in your book, Voices in the Ocean by Peter Matheson.
Well, I take that as a big compliment.
Well, yeah, it's a towering work that we all look at, but good luck to you, and please come back.
I love it here.
Thank you very much, and Juliet, thank you for being a good sport.